we go. Good morning, everyone. Welcome. My name is Pastor Ernie Barr with Faith Lutheran Church, and I identify myself not just for our Zoom folks, that's mostly members of our congregation and friends, but also for our youth Facebook Live people. We're glad that you could be with us today. Happy Mother's Day to everyone. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Grandmother's Day. Happy Foster Mother's Day. All those things, mothers. It's good to see you all, and happy Mother's Day. I'm glad you could be with us. And happy Mother's Day to those of us who have lost our mothers. We know that they are celebrating this day in heaven, and it is a good day for them as well. So good day. Good to have you all with us today. John Kruger will be our lector here in just a few moments. We're glad that you could join us. And let us begin our morning with a brief order for confession and forgiveness. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And together, let us confess. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen and amen. Our gathering hymn this morning is Alleluia, Jesus is Risen. If you happen to have a hymn book, it's number 377.
Thank you.
Amen. I love that hymn. Let us pray. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Almighty God, your Son, Jesus Christ, is the way, the truth, and the life. Give us grace to love one another, to follow in the ways of his commandments, and to share his risen life with all the world. For he lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit as one God, now and forever. Amen and amen. We will now have our readings. Our lecturer this morning is John Kruger. John?
Good morning. Today's first reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 7, verses 55 through 60. But being full of the Holy Spirit, he gazed intently into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. And he said, "Behold, I see the heavens opened up and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." But they cried out with a loud voice and covered their ears and rushed at him with one impulse. When they had driven him out of the city, they began stoning him, and the witnesses laid aside their robes at the feet of the young man named Saul. They went on stoning Stephen as he called on the Lord and said, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then, falling on his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." Having said this, he fell asleep. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's psalm is Psalm 31, verses 1 through 5 and 15 and 16. In you, O Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be ashamed. In your righteousness, deliver me. Incline your ear to me. Rescue me quickly. Be to me a rock of strength, a stronghold to save me. For you are my rock and my fortress. For your name's sake, you will lead me and guide me. You will pull me out of the net which they have secretly laid for me. For you are my strength. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have ransomed me, O Lord, God of truth. My times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and from those who persecute me. Make your face to shine upon your servant. Save me in your loving kindness. Today's second reading is from the book of 1 Peter, chapter 2, verses 2 through 10. Like newborn babies, long for the pure milk of the word, so that by it you may grow in respect to salvation. If you have tasted the kindness of the Lord, and coming to him as to a living stone which has been rejected by men, but is choice and precious in the sight of God, you also, as living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For this is contained in Scripture. Behold, I lay in Zion a choice of stone, a precious cornerstone, and he who believes in him will not be disappointed. This precious value, then, is for you who believe. But for those who disbelieve, the stone which the builders rejected, this became the very cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. For they stumble because they are disobedient to the word, and to this doom they are also appointed. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. For you were not a people, but now are the people of God. You had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Our gospel this morning comes from the Gospel of St. John, the 14th chapter. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going. But Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said to him, Lord, show us a Father, and we will be satisfied. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. In my name, if you ask for anything, I will do it. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Grace to you and peace from God the Father and from Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Good to see you all this morning. Our gospel kind of takes a little turn. This is from what's called the Farewell Discourse in John's Gospel. And it seems to me that it touches on that moment in our lives. Psychologists sometimes, on the one hand, they say that we're products of our nurture. In other words, our relationships and the way that we're raised, the way that we're brought up, that we naturally respond to the world around us based on that life experience, that nurture that we've received or maybe have not received. Other psychologists say, well, that may be true, but really we're more products of our genetic code. In other words, the nature that is within us. In other words, if we are predisposed in a certain situation to respond with violence or anger, then that's just part of our genetic makeup. And that's just a matter of fact who we are. And I believe that maybe, you know, it's a combination of both and not necessarily either or. I think that we are a product of our genetic code and the nurture that we've received. But more importantly, it seems to me that sometimes when crisis hits, when bad things happen in our lives, and that's where I think this Farewell Discourse picks up very nicely, is that sometimes, regardless of our nature or nurture or any of those things, sometimes we land in a place that is so foreign to our experience or our understanding of the world that sometimes we just don't know what to do and we're not sure how to handle it. And I'm talking beyond coping skills. This is something bigger than that. This is something where we land in such a foreign territory that we're just not sure even have to make sense of those things that are hitting us so harshly. And I'm not talking about faith crisis. I have spoken about faith crisis quite often, and I will continue to do so because it's a real thing. But to me, faith crisis is where we've decided that there is no God. I'm very hesitant to speak in absolute terms, but to me, faith crisis is where we've just decided that, you know, there's just no possible way that there could even be a God anymore. I'm not talking about that this morning. I'm talking about something that for pastoral care workers or for all of us who tend to those people who may be in crisis, sometimes this can be even worse than a faith crisis. And by that, I mean, what Jesus is really, it seems to me, addressing and part of what I think our text is leading us toward is that place in our lives where we still believe in God. I mean, that's kind of as a matter of fact, maybe in our core theology. But our core theology has been so rattled that now we're angry at God and we're so mad at God that now we're not sure exactly how to make sense of it, but we are certain that whatever has happened or is happening is God's fault. And maybe God didn't cause it to happen, but God certainly could have prevented it from happening. And therein lies the rub, and therein lies, it seems to me, not faith crisis, but something much, much, much worse and much darker. It is a moment in our life where we're so angry at God that naturally makes us really angry at the world. And then when people come to us and try to offer comfort, it almost blows up because we have made up our mind. And how many of you know that sometimes we can make up our mind to the point that we can put a wall up where we no longer hear what anybody is saying or anything that anyone is doing anymore? We're just like, I don't want to hear it. I already know that God is mean, God is judgment, God is anger, and there's nothing you can say that can change our minds. And sometimes that is the absolute truth. And sometimes all we can do is say, well, bless you, you'll be my prayers, and walk away, because anything we say is just going to make the situation worse. Now, I know that none of our listeners would ever do that, that none of you would ever be in a position where you say, I'm not going to listen to anything you say. No one in our congregation would ever take that position. I'm sure of it. However, once in a while, maybe we have heard that in our life experience. And that, to me, is exactly what Jesus is speaking about this morning. This is called the Farewell Discourse on purpose, because these are the last words, that some of the last words, that Jesus spoke to his disciples on the night in which he's betrayed, just before all reality is about to cut loose on them, and they are going to have no life experience. There's no genetic code, no nurture, nothing in their life that is going to be able to help them through what's about to happen in their lives. And they will be scattered, and bad things are going to happen. That's part of the problem, is that, you know, we get angry at God that bad things happen in our life, because God does maintain the integrity of the creation, I believe. In other words, I think that's code language for death does happen. We are going to die. That's just part of nature. That's part of the world. That is just how it is. Hurricanes will happen. Tornadoes are going to happen. Disease is going to hit us and our loved ones. I mean, stuff still happens. Jesus was still crucified. He was the Son of the living God, and look what happened to him. I mean, God maintains the integrity of the created order, and that's just the way it is. I do believe in miracles where God can intercede, but I believe miracles happen in many times in unexpected ways, and that's what Jesus is speaking about this morning. It's interesting to me that he says, you know, if you're not going to, I know, and I'm paraphrasing greatly, bad things are about to happen, and if you get to the point where you can't believe my words any longer, then at the very least, believe in the actions I've done. Look at what's followed in my wake. Believe in me, at least for the sake of what you've seen and what you've observed. Now, let me back up 1 minute. This is a rabbit trail, but it is very much intentionally so. There's that verse 6 that speaks of Jesus being the way, the truth, and the life. That particular verse, is, as far as words are concerned, has been weaponized to the point where people have become violent over the notion that the only way to God, you know, is through Jesus. And yes, I'm perfectly capable of reading the words myself. But what I want to encourage you to believe and to understand is that it's not how Jesus intended this. He never intended for Christianity to be an exclusive cult. That was never the goal. And that is not the intention of his words. And I would encourage you to go back and read the entire Farewell Discourse without that verse, and then come back and tell me whether or not you're able to still weaponize that one verse and use it against people rather than for people and with people in crisis and without the intention of bringing comfort. His whole goal is to bring comfort. Okay, that was my rabbit trail, but let me come back. So Jesus says, if you're not going to believe in my words, the words that I love you and the Father is in me and I'm in the Father and this is all one big thing, if you're not going to believe me, at the very least, look at what's happened in my way. Look at the actions I've done. And so believe in God for the sake of the abundance which God provided when people were hungry on the hillside, when they were on the plain, and when people were starving, and Jesus produced food seemingly out of nothing and out of nowhere. Believe in me for the sake of those who were possessed by demons and could not even get cannot even be a part of their communities anymore because they were thrown into the outer world of cemeteries and death and destruction and they were ostracized from the community and believe in me for those exorcisms where I drove out those demons, where I restored people back into community. Believe in me for the sake of those who restored back and made whole where before there was no hope. Believe in me for the actions where I showed up and, you know, and I spoke to women with respect and with integrity and with honor, that I would speak to anyone, to all people. Believe in me for the sake of the children whom I loved and I welcomed and I brought into my lap and all of those folks who have been have been made to feel, for whatever reason, less than in culture and society. Believe in me for those, and for those sakes of my experience of loving all humanity right where they were, just as they were, without any conditions. Believe in me for the ones who committed seemingly stone-worthy sin, and yet I was there to say, you know, let the one who has not sinned cast the first stone. Believe in me for the forgiveness. Believe in me for the integrity. Believe in me for the honor that I showed all people. And believe in me, this to me is so critical, that even in death, we cannot be separated. And, you know, and I don't know, maybe this particular Mother's Day, it's kind of hit me hard, that particular verse, you know, that I'm going to prepare a place for you. There's a reason people read this text at memorial services and funerals, because it reminds us that even in our deepest, darkest despairs, and many times that is at a point of death of a loved one, is that God still always has, always did, and always will desire to dwell with us and to be one with us. And even in death, Jesus says, you know, even in death, I'm going to prepare a place for you, because God desires to be with us always, even through eternity. I mean, those verses that remind us that neither height nor depth nor nothing in creation, than heaven or hell or anywhere else, can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. That's the kind of stuff Jesus is talking about. That's the kind of stuff that his actions led us to believe, that nothing can separate us from God's love, not even death. And that if anything, it draws us even closer together, because at moments of crisis, that's when the people of God do step up. That's when we see the face of God, you know, in the person of Marilyn Lautner, the person of Nancy and Di and all of you. That's where we see God show up in the flesh, you know, the risen body of Christ is in. And maybe we are, or do we get in those places where we may be angry with God, but at the very least, we can see God's tenderness, and we can see God's love, and we can see God's presence in each other and in those faces that come to us to remind us that we don't go through whatever this mess is, we're not alone. Even if it's a global pandemic, here we are. Here we are together, and here we are offering comfort to one another, reminding each other that we really aren't alone in this, that God did not abandon us, that God's promise is to dwell with us always, even on this side of death and even on the other side of death. God's promise is to always be with us, even when we're the most angry. Even if we're in faith crisis, God certainly is not. God, you know, even when we lash out and we say the most horrific things that many of us would probably be appalled if we heard coming out of each other's mouths, but probably all of us have uttered one way or the other, either silently or even aloud, and that is our anger at God. Even then, in our deepest, darkest, most angry moments in our lives, God is there loving us through it. God is there seeing us through. God is there showing up with abundance, with healing, with restoration, with forgiveness, and God's presence. And nothing on heaven or earth can ever change that. God's love through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen and amen. May the peace which passes all human understanding keep all of our hearts and all of our minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen and amen. All right, just a minute. Normally I'd have a hymn. Okay, let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Uplifted by the promised hope of healing and resurrection, we join the people of God in all times and places in praying for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Build us up, Mothering God, as living stones united in your spiritual house. Continually strengthen your church as it is sent forth to proclaim your love. We pray especially for new congregations and for those who are in redevelopment and for those who maybe were just beginning to get their feet on the ground when this pandemic hit. Keep them strong, gracious God. Keep them together and united in love and in purpose and in commitment to your mission, where you have sent us all out into the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Humble us, Creator God, as part of your creation. Fill us with respect and awe for the world you have made, including volcanoes, ocean currents, tropical rainstorms, glaciers, and other forces that both destroy and create. Help remind us, gracious God, that when you created all of creation, the created order, that it was good, and that your intention is good for all humanity. But even when things do not go the way that maybe we had hoped or the way that we desire, that you are the creator, and help us to always trust in your love and your good intentions for all humanity. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Align our ways to your love, O God. We pray for countries, leaders, and other organizations as they prepare places for those seeking refuge and safety. And we especially pray for those who do not have homes and who are sent out in refuge in strange places that are trying to maintain social distance, but are struggling even for daily food and for water. And for those who are struggling through food lines and through this pandemic, help us, gracious God, to be sensitive to their needs, to be generous with what the abundance you have blessed us with, so that we can help those food banks in our local communities and wherever you may have sent us. Help us to be generous in that abundance. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of healing and rest, help those whose hearts are heavy and weighed down by many troubles. Comfort their suffering, ease their distress, and carry their burdens. Especially we pray for all those who may have lost loved ones this week, for those who may be suffering from any sort of from any sort of crisis that may have hit their lives. And Lord, we know that we have been made alert to several folks who are going through some very personal distress. Be with them, gracious God. Surround them with your love and mercy in only way that you can do. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Nurturing God, we pray for those who tend to teach young children, especially these days on the internet and the different ways that they're trying to reach out. We pray for those who are pregnant and for expectant parents all over the globe, for families who are struggling with infertility and even miscarriage, for mothers everywhere, gracious God. We give you thanks for their nurture, for their care, for their love that they've given all of us. We give thanks for all those who have shown mothering care, and remember all for whom this day might be difficult. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, you call into your brilliant light all who have died. Give us faith to take hold of the promise of your eternal life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And with bold confidence in your love, Almighty God, we place all for whom we pray into your eternal care. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always, and also with you. Let us share a sign of that peace, either with ourselves or with someone who may be with us. Peace. If you have not done so, you might gather a piece of bread and a pot of wine so that we continue with Holy Communion. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God our thanks and praise. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup. And after giving thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." United as God's people, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen and amen. Let us enjoy now and partake in the body of Christ. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Body of Christ given for me. blood Christ shed for me. All right. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen and amen. Our sending hymn this morning is number 674. If you happen to have a hymnal, it is Let Us Talents and Tongues Employ. And I believe, Dale, you had a couple of comments here.
I did. The only time this song repeats or the refrain repeats is after the third verse. And it will repeat three times.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you. Now let us go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Just a reminder, we will gather together again just like this next week. We have a meeting this week with our local Senate people in our conference, and it sounds like the general consensus is that we will not the numbers have all decreased for like 2 weeks. And so certainly for May, we'll not gather together in May in live. So I'm hoping for the first Sunday in June, but we'll see how that goes. Let us pray that the pandemic just goes away. And let us pray that we can get together first Sunday in June. That's the hope, that's the prayer, and that so far is the goal. So, all right, Dale, if you will unmute us all so we can all say hello. Thank you all, Facebook Live, for joining us. See you next week.
See you next week.
See you next week.
Happy Mother's Day, everybody.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day.
Thank you.
Okay. See you next time.
See you next week.
Bye. Happy Mother's Day.
Bye, everybody. Have a great day.
Bye.
Hi.
As you shut this down, you need to show me how to get back on next week.
I was thinking we should write down instructions.
Good idea.
But how do you?